Hey, hi, I'm Bill Boggs, and your video is going to start in a second, but I want to tell you about my new satirical novel, The Adventures of Spike the Wonder Dog, about a very funny canine who becomes a television star. It takes you behind the scenes of TV talk shows like you're watching here. Pre-order The Adventures of Spike the Wonder Dog on Amazon today. Spike and I thank you.
This hotel has been home for kings and queens, moguls and movie stars. In fact, when John F. Kennedy was president, the Carlyle Hotel was known as the New York White House. Great people also come here from all over the world to see and hear this man, Bobby Short, a singer with impeccable taste and a romantic touch, who's famed for singing the great songs from all eras. Join us tonight as we go to his musical domain, the Cafe Carlyle. Since the late 60s, Bobby Short has been weaving a romantic spell in this room, and he's made many friends. There's Tony Bennett, a great performer who appreciates other performers. Alice Faye and critic Rex Reed. Lucy Arnaz and husband Lawrence Luckinbill. And two-time Oscar winner Jack Lemmon. Actress Monique Van Voorn. Actor Barry Bostwick with actress Lisa Hartman. Artist Leroy Neiman. Famed photographer Scavullo, and actor-director Jeffrey Holden, all waiting for the man who's been called the greatest cafe entertainer in the world, Mr. Bobby Short.
I love the look of you, the lure of you, the sweet of you, the pure of you, the eyes, the arms, the mouth of you, the east, west, north, and the south of you. I'd love to laze with you and doze with you and learn the secret of sweet repose with you. So give a gent a small percent of you to, 'cause I love all of you. I love the look of you, the lure of you. I'd like to make a tour of you. The face, the grace, the charm of you. The two, three, four, five alarm of you. You'll never know how much I'd give for you. I'd die for you, but I'd rather live for you. So love at least a small percent of me, do, 'cause I love all of you.
So there's Bobby. We're going to bring on Bill Boggs, and we have two other great people qualified, very qualified to talk about Bobby Short. Lauren Schoenberg and Eric Comstock will be here. They're waiting in the wings patiently, but we will start with Bill Boggs because Bill goes back the furthest with Bobby Short. In fact, Bill Boggs and Bobby Short have one major thing in common. They're both New York icons, although neither one of them, unlike me, neither one of them is actually from here, but they both moved here as young men and became New York institutions. Although Bill is so vibrant and so alive and so active, it's hard to refer to him as an institution, but certainly a New York icon, just like Bobby Short. And it's so amazing that you, the two of you, were able to get together in what really, you know, judging from your work, it seems like the 70s was a great era, although you know, it's still an interesting period. But how First of all, when did you first hear Bobby Short? When did you first meet him? And how did you come to do that, to produce that amazing video, which I think everybody would agree, it's the definitive video of Bobby, certainly at the Carlisle.
Well, first off, thank you for having me. I'm honored to be on with Lauren and Eric and everybody. I love, as you know, I've loved music and singers all my life and clubs. So a brief history of Bobby Short and Bill Boggs. Back in 68, 69, I was associate producer of a talk show in morning talk show called Betty Hughes and Friends in Philadelphia while I was managing Patrick in Tarsus. And I read about this place in New York, this great place, the Cafe Carlisle, and Bobby Short, he was getting publicity. And we had a budget to bring guests in and stay overnight. So I got it. I was a talent coordinator. So I got in touch with Bobby Short, and he agreed to come down. He stayed overnight nearby and came over to WCAU for a live show at 9 a.m. and did a couple songs. And he saw that I appreciated him. It was the first time I ever heard him sing, was that morning, actually, on live television. And so as the years went by, coming to New York, he was on Midday, and the show that you just saw, at the very top, Bobby Short Live at the Carlisle, that was a Boggs Baker production. In 1980, Richard Baker, who was one of my great friends, associate producer of Live from Lincoln Center, and I formed a production company, Boggs Baker Productions. And the first several, this is how we led to that show. The first shows we did were for MTV. We did Frank Zappa at the Palladium Live. We did Mink DeVille, Lou Reed at the Bottom Line, and Ian Hunter on the Pier. And then we ran out of people to do. We almost had to deal with Ozzy Osbourne. And we met Ozzy Osbourne at 9 a.m. for breakfast at the Essex House. He had been up all night. And we, of course, were just showing up. And we almost had to deal with U2, but these two deals fell through. So I said, who do we know? I said, Bobby Short. So we went to our distribution people. And I said, Richard and I said, how about Bobby Short live at the Carlisle with a fantasy audience, a black tie, celebrities, the way you imagine it would be? And they said, yeah, right away. So we went over to Bobby Short, set up a meeting, went up to him, and Richard Baker, and I said, how much do you think we should pay him? We had a pretty good budget. And I said, I don't know, how about like $15,000? This is like 82 or 83. So, okay, so we said, we'll offer him $15,000. So we're having the meeting, blah, blah, blah. And I said, now with compensation, I think about 15,000. And his eyes go, that will be just fine, just like that. So Bobby said to me, Bill, you know my material well. You picked the song list. He was a pleasure to work with, a pleasure to work with. And I wrote that opening, the fantasy opening. So a couple of interesting side notes of the show. The first, the day, the week, the show was taped on a Monday night, right? That weekend, it was like the winter. Bobby had a gig in Kansas City or some, and all we could think about is he's going to get snowed in. But no, he made the gig. He came back. Then he calls me on the phone. He says, by the way, well, don't be shocked. I'm going to wear my toupee for the taping. I thought, oh my God, what is this going to be? It's going to look like Fred Astaire at the end, But no, it was just something that covered him over in the back. And all the celebrities were essentially waiting to get into the room. This was directed and shot. It was directed by the director of Live from Lincoln Center. Richard Baker was associate producer and the cameraman from Live from Lincoln Center. It was really a carefully put together production, as you could say. 15 minutes before we're ready to let everyone in, the lighting grid that we built in order to have very good lighting collapsed, fell onto the piano, hit bassist Beverly Pierce's bass, knocked a chip out of his bass. This is when I learned that I had a great partner, Richard Baker, because we had production insurance to pay for the bass. The bass played okay, but it had a chip out of this 110-year-old bass. Anyway, I was honestly one of the most tense times in my life. We had all these celebrities, had to go in Bemo's bar. We had enough money on the tab, buy everybody a drink. Everybody gets oiled up. we had to get a piano tuner to race over and retune the piano. My heart is pounding. We started about 50 minutes late. I remember just sitting there with this guy going, bing, bing, bing on every key, bing, bing. And then Bobby comes down, man, and we just let it roll. And it includes a lovely duet with Lucy Arnaz. It includes Jack Lemmon at the Carlisle, Jack Lemmon playing piano. And I think he plays with Bobby for a while.
Yes. Does
he play 400 piano?
We can show that if you like. We have that.
Yeah, it's an interesting clip. I think it's a historic clip. Jack Lemmon is someone I had had on Midday several times. He was on a Father's Day show with my father. He was on, I think, with Jane Fonda in the movie they made about the nuclear meltdown. He was on about four or five times. Jack Lemmon was a wonderful guy, terrific personality, really, really bright man. And when I found out he could play the piano, Richard and I invited him to come and be part of it and sit down. And Hugh Downs, who was not pictured among those celebrities, but was there, loved Jack. He comes over, oh, and Hugh Downs was going on about Jack Lemmon's piano playing. So that's the story of how Bobby Short at the Carlisle got made. And that show was available at home video, and it aired for about 4 years on New Year's Eve on PBS. And in an enormously satisfying piece of work for Richard and I. And then the next morning I got up and went in and did Midday Live, because that's what I was doing at the time. And the Boggs Baker Productions was something we did that actually led to Comedy Tonight. But all that stuff was done during that fertile period of my life, the 12 years that I spent on Midday. That's it. That's my wrap on this. I don't know what I wanted to say. Why, one other thing.
Sure, go for it.
If I were to say, you know, what is there about Bobby Short that really captured me? Music to me has always given me the ability to rise above things and see things through the music and the lyrics that I wouldn't see necessarily without the music and the lyrics. But with Bobby, he helped me to rise above things and see that how elegant it could all be. There was a sense of an evening at the Carlisle of enormous elegance for me. And Bobby was an acquired taste. I know that Sylvia Sims told me Sinatra did not like Bobby, didn't dig his singing. Lady Jane Rothschild herself, no. But he just had, you either dug him or you didn't, but I just thought he was in a class, Bobby Short was in a class by himself, as far as I was concerned.
Well, let's look at that couple more clips from that, and then we'll look at the Midday Live interview, and then whatever you like. But yeah, we'll go on talking about Bobby, and then we'll bring on Lauren and Eric in a little bit as well. So it's a fun, will truly be, as promised, a Bobby birthday bonanza, as promised.
Again, Will, thank you for including me.
Oh,
a pleasure. Really a pleasure to look back on that night. Really is.
Well, it's just such a great piece of footage. I wish that there were, you know, I wish it was a weekly series, Bobby at the Carlisle. You know, I wish there was a zillion more hours of him there. All right, here's Jack Lemmon's solo and his four-handed piece with Bobby on Love Walked In.
We're in our 14th year here at the Cafe Carlisle, and more I'm less and less surprised that half our audience is composed of closet piano players and singers, sometimes just singers, sometimes just piano players. But we have a lot of audience around here who are really very talented people. They're principally doctors and lawyers and sometimes even actors and models, but photographers. But they often play the piano as well. And in that case, we have tonight with us a very old customer and certainly a very, very dear old friend and a very, very special fellow who's made his way in the acting world right and left and up and down. Oh, there he is now, anyway. Untangle yourself, Jackson. Ladies and gentlemen, Jack Lemmon. Get up here, baby. Oh! Plug it in somewhere. Get up here. You done it? Now hide that contraption.
It just so happened. I'm sorry about that.
I think it's great.
For a terrible moment, I thought it was my liver. All right. Okay, let's...
Well, it's nice to see you. Shake my hand. You piano
After
player,
what
you.
You've done, I'll kiss
well,
you on both cheeks.
I think that's awfully nice.
That you Generous. Have seen my golf game, haven't you?
Yes.
Well, the piano playing is sometime akin to that, so forget it. Three swats in
I'll
a trap and then
the
pick it up and throw
right
it.
Here.
What the
it's
hell, whatever. We'll do
that.
Something here. Oh, my God, so far it's wonderful.
So far it's Gershwin, too, which is...
something. I'm going to get the hell out of here while I'm still alive.
Hey, Jack.
I love you, Robert. Thank you, buddy.
Hey, don't you dare move. Don't you dare move.
Fetch his slippers, fill up the pipe he smokes. I cook the kippers and laugh at his oldest jokes. Yet here I anchor, I might have had a banker. Boy, what love has done to me. My life he's wrecking. I'll bet you could find him now, out somewhere necking somebody else's frau. You get to know life when married to a low life. boy, what love has done to me. When a guy looks my way, does he get emphatic? Say he gets dramatic. I just want to fly away. But if I left him, I'd be all at sea. I'm just a slavey. Life's a funny thing. He gets the gravy, but I got a wedding ring. And still I love him. There's nobody above him. Boy, what love has done to me. I can't hold my head up. The butcher, the baker, oh no, he's a faker. Brother, am I fed up? Where will I wind up? I don't know where I'm at. I make my mind up. I'm gonna leave him flat. And still I've grown so. I love the dirty so-and-so. Oh!
And what? What do you sing?
Sing a New York song.
A New York song, like this. That one? Give me E flat, Beverly. Nice and easy.
Today I feel New York is really my personal property. Right down Broadway to City Hall. Every supermarket, every 5 and 10, the Lincoln Center and the great UN, it's all my personal property. Zoo in Central Park is merely my private menagerie. I've carved my name on every tree. From the Yonkers Raceway down to Bowling Green, all around it, all the in-between, it's all my personal property. The planetarium is mine alone. The old aquarium I also own. And since today I feel New York is really my personal property, I'll tell you what I'm gonna do. So very, very much, I'm gonna split it with you. Today I feel New York is really my personal property. Right down Broadway to City Hall. Every supermarket, every 5 and 10, the Lincoln Center and the great UN, it's all my personal property. The zoo in Central Park is merely my private menagerie. I've carved my name on every tree. From the youngest race Broadway, down the Bowling Green, all around it, all the in between. It's all my personal property, the planetarium is mine alone, the old aquarium I also own. And since today I feel New York is really my personal property, I'll tell you what I'm gonna do. Since I like you very much, so very, very much, I'm gonna split it with you. Since I like you very much, so very, very much,
just indulge me for 30 seconds of a tip jingle, and we'll be back with our wonderful guest, Bill Boggs. Hooray, hooray, hooray. And then Lauren and Eric and more Bobby Short birthday bonanza. 31 seconds of our tip jingle. Hooray.
Tip it.
That's right. It's tip it.
Show to sell. If you put a little tip, tip, tippy in a kitty, hey, that would be real swell.
Expecting much bigger tip.
Hooray! So, just want to quickly say, please remember the tip jar is open for your custom. We will take anything, a check in the mail, cash on the dresser, or change behind the couch cushions. We're going to go back to Bill now. Da-da-da-da-da. So Bill, that is such a great video, and I think you said that your favorite number was personal property. It's mine too. I've shown that more than any other.
Yeah, I love that. You know, honest Will and everybody watching, it's a thrill for me to see this. Although Richard Baker and I produced the show, I have not seen the show or looked at it since the year we did it, since we had a screening. So our goal, Richard Baker, our goal was to make you, the viewer, feel as if you were there at the Carlisle. And you know, all these years later, we did achieve that goal. And Kurt Browning, I believe, is the name of the director, who shot just really good direction. So it's fulfilling to share this with people. It really is. Well, thank you.
Well, it must be especially gratifying because watching it at this point in our lives, you don't have to worry about the piano being out of tune or the lights falling and killing somebody. So I'm sure you're enjoying it more now than you were 40 years ago. You know?
Absolutely. That was just a tense night, but I think Richard and I knew we really had a special show because we didn't make it slick. We let it happen the way it really happened, you know? Jack, we didn't just, we have to edit out Jack Lemmon, he's having a problem. Oh, we have to do this, that's not right. We more or less let you really be in the room. And it's always been my theory as a producer that to the extent that you can just take somebody there and not pretend it's a play where everything has to go, don't worry even about breaking the proscenium sometimes. I think it's okay. But Bobby was really again easy to work with, a pleasure to work with, and as elegant as he was, as the great airs that he conveyed, he was just a really down to earth guy to work with. And I think he was grateful that he was captured on video at a time when he had, you know, was really in many ways near the zenith and the peak of his powers and popularity. We're not going to see the likes of Bobby Short in the Carlisle too soon, ever again, probably, ever again.
Well, the closest we can come is Eric Comstock and
Barbara. I was thinking, I'd the venues where we see Eric, I particularly like looking forward to seeing him at Birdland on the 5 o'clock show with Sean Smith and Babs, as we like to call her. And that's a different kind of vibe. It's and Eric conveys a similar erudite knowledge of the music and elegance. And Birdland itself can feel really wonderful. And the sound system in that room is excellent. I've always loved nightclubs. And if you said, okay, and I've been to a lot of them. I was started going to Latin Casino when I was in college and, you know, in the early 60s, and that's in Cherry Hill, New Jersey. And I would count the Cafe Carlisle among the top five places where I've ever seen shows in the world ever, you know. And thanks to you, I saw Buster Poindexter there.
Oh.
I
love Buster Point. I hope they bring him back. I hope they reopen. I hope.
Anyway, well, what else can we talk about?
Last thing before I let you go. You had Bobby on Midday Live promoting the Newport Jazz Festival, which is a wonderful for this particular moment when we're also honoring the memory of the great George Wein. How did you happen to do that that Newport tribute with Bobby? What was that?
Trevor, my son, and a couple of people are talking about possibly trying to do a documentary that would be not totally about me, but be centered on there was a time in our culture when daytime talk, like Midday Live that I did, or the Time Out show that I did in Philadelphia, where Miles Davis came down, where you could really do 90 minutes. You can't even imagine doing a 90-minute daytime show today that would focus on anything for 90 minutes, let alone like the Newport Jazz Festival.
Yeah.
So, but one, you know, the staff knew I liked music and I had passion for music, and as you can tell, I still do. So we had George Wein, by the way, I believe was on that show about the Newport Jazz Festival. It was the Newport Jazz Festival being in New York, right? Yes.
Right.
So we just booked a number of guests who were on, Bobby came on, and I don't know if you have the clip, but the clip with Bobby playing with Jerry Mulligan, which I said to these guys in the green room, how about playing together? You know, like having a musical encounter of the first kind, Bobby Short and Jerry Mulligan. And they said, that's great, let's do it. I mean, that's the sort of stuff you could do. It wasn't slick, you could make it happen, and you could even alter it because live on the air, because no one was gonna stop me if I started to do something live.
Well, let's watch. We have Bobby doing as Long As I Live. I don't remember if that's with Mulligan or not, but.
I don't think that's one, but it's Sweet Georgia Brown with Mulligan. But all this stuff, 450 clips are on my YouTube channel, Bill Boggs TV. And you'll see some of the Bobby there, and Bobby with Jerry Mulligan and Bucky Pizzarelli playing, I think with Milt Jackson, whatever.
Wow.
But if you go to Bill Boggs TV, it's free. Subscribe and spread the word. I've spent the last 11 years curating it. And well, you know something about curating things, I believe.
I'm a curator from way back.
You are right. You are almost curated.
And there's no cure for curation, unfortunately. All right, here we go. This is just one clip from Midday, and then we'll probably come on with Lauren, who I know has got much to say about this particular subject.
Hi, Bill Boggs here. Welcome to our program today. We are going to bring into your home some of the best jazz available in the world, and we have some terrific people who are going to play it for you today. As we salute and welcome back to New York, the incredible Newport Jazz Festival in its 26 years. Came to New York to work on a television show. I used to come to New York for various cultural reasons, and one of the reasons was Bobby Short. Frequently, I first met Bobby Short even before I got into television. I've been a fan of his. We know him as a tremendous song stylist, and I think we overlook the fact, and I said this once before in the program, that you are a terrific jazz pianist.
Well, with Sidemen like I just had, I can't miss.
Can't miss. What are you doing in the Jazz Festival?
I'm producing and performing, which is a new kind of role for me.
I imagine you'd be a very good producer.
Well, I hope so. My co-producer is Robert Kimball, who is very erudite in matters musical, that is. And we're going to be producing an evening called Black Broadway.
Black Broadway, based on...
It's all about participation of blacks on the Broadway stage from the first part of the century to 1945.
So you'll be drawing from what kind of composers?
Oh, from the earliest, like lyricists like Paul Laurence Dunbar, the 19th century poet, and J. Rosamond Johnson and Bob Coles, who wrote operettas back in those days. Of course, U.B. Blake, and we're going to sidestep Treemonisha, because that's been done and done and done. But we're going to include composers like Harold Arlen, who wrote things for the Cotton Club parades of yesteryear, and Vernon Duke and Duke Ellington, of course.
The Cotton Club parades were performed where? On Broadway?
They were performed at the Cotton Club. We're cheating a tiny bit because we felt that a lot of good music was composed for those shows, and great performers performed the music.
Now, I want you to do something from your program, but first, let's get it memorized. Where is it going to be and when?
It's Avery Fisher Hall, 8 o'clock p.m., June 24th. That's a Sunday.
Sunday night, Avery Fisher Hall.
Yeah.
You want to do something by Harold Arlen?
Yes.
From which
This production? Is from a Cotton Club parade of the early 1930s, I believe, Bill, and it was sung by Avon Long and Lena Horne.
Oh, wow. All right, let's hear it.
Maybe I can't live to love you as long as I want to, but I can promise you, baby, I'm gonna love you as long as I live. Maybe I can't give you diamonds and things like I want to, but I can promise you, baby, I'm gonna want to as long as I live. I never cared, but now I'm scared I won't live long enough. That's why I wear my rubbers when it rains, and eat an apple every day, and see the doctor anyway. What if I can't live to love you as long as I want to? Life isn't long enough, baby, but I can love you as long as I can. What's the use? There's no excuse to keep hiding what's on my mind. Loving you is a secret I can't conceal. Since we met, I've been so upset, so I simply made up my mind to confess just exactly the way I feel. I even wear long underwear when winter breezes blow. I want to take good care of me, because a sneeze or two might mean the flu, and that would never, never do. What if I can't live to love you as long as I want to?
Excellent. So I will stop the share, and I'm going to invite Lauren Schoenberg to unmute. Let me do that.
I'm here.
There you are. You're unmuted. Hooray.
Hey, hooray.
Lauren Schoenberg, executive director of the National Jazz Museum in Harlem. Is that the official title?
No. I'm head Schmendrick.
Your chief raccoon.
No, I'm now the senior scholar there. We have a wonderful executive director. But anyway, thank you, Will. Thanks for having me. And it's great to see Bill, who I cruised the heist.
Hello, Lauren. Hello. Hey, Bill. It's been a long time. It's good to see you as well.
It's good to see you. We cruised the high seas together. I mean, that's not code talk, but we actually...
that's literal, right.
We actually did, but I have to tell you...
Lauren, your camera's out of focus. I don't know what the reason is.
I can fix that.
As I was just saying, I think in any production, you just correct what's going on and see if you can. I'm sorry, Will, I just thought I'd mention
that. No, it's true.
How about now?
That time we were having dinner, Will, and I had the tomato all over my mouth, and you said, Bill, look, that girl over there, and then you got something on your mouth.
Is that better?
Yeah.
Yes.
Perfect. Okay.
I can see you in all your glory.
Right. So, you know, I, Bill already touched on so many of the things about Bobby that I wanted to talk about. I'll just talk from my personal experience, but I'll just tell you, you know, seeing that video of the Carlisle, I had already been there by that time. The 70s in New York, I moved to New York in 76 to go to music school. And I think I forgot if I told Bob this. I'm not going to tell Bill that I actually had a crush on him. But the truth is that I actually used to go to tapings of your show on E67th Street?
Yeah, 205 E67.
Right. I went to tapings and...
You're the one who was there. I got it.
Oh, man. No, but I was there and actually shook your hand a couple of times, but I was a big... That's the truth. And because it represented, you know, not to get mawkish about it, but, you know, just like you were saying, a time when in major media, on major, you know, on New York network television, there was like intelligence and like interviews and long form and all long this form. Stuff. Yeah. And so I'll give you my Bobby Short story just quickly. I met Bobby in 1972 when I was 14. And I was already going towards that kind of music and studying the piano. And he was at the a theater called The Circle and the Round, I think was the name, or somewhere like that. It was in Westchester, and it was a stage that rotated. Well, anyway, my parents took me to see him. And this is an odd story, I'll confess here. And don't you ever use this, Will, because this is just between us. My best friend, I mean, I came from a liberal Jewish household. My best friend, who's still a good friend of mine 50 years later, was a staunch Republican even at 14, and believe it or not, was working on the Nixon re-election campaign as a 14-year-old.
Oh my god,
dragged me along, much along to my parents' horror. And anyway, went to see Bobby Short, and I was so enamored. And Will, I met you probably not that long after that, that, you know, I used to make cassette tapes for people. You know what I mean? Like, I've got to make cassette tapes.
So we used to call
it. I made a cassette tape for Bobby Short of Cole Porter Things, sent it to him. He lived in Carnegie Hall, I guess, at that point. He lived on West 57th Street. And lo and behold, and it's in my scrapbook, I got a typed letter back from Bobby Short when I was 14. And it starts out with, "Of course I remember meeting you. You were the young man with the Nixon button."
Oh boy!
It's a true story.
And you later wound up working with Leonard Garment.
That's why I
had an expression of surprise. Not that somebody would support Nixon, but that you later worked with Leonard Garment, who was his guy.
Right,
you
know? Right. So anyway, fast forward. I met Bobby. So I went to see Bobby as a kid with my parents. I mean, we would. It was once every 2 years. Couldn't really afford it. Went to the Carlisle to see Bobby, and that's when I got a taste of what Bill was talking about, which is kind of being transported through that video to that room with the Vertej paintings on the wall and the waiters and all this kind of stuff. And then I met Bobby socially through Gene Bach, the late great Gene Bach, who was a close friend. They were tight as could be. They had known each other since they were teenagers. And so I met him through that socially. And then we were in the wings of Lincoln Center. We were both appearing on a fundraiser for Jazz Lincoln Center. And I facetiously said to Bobby backstage, I said, "You know, Bobby, you need a band, man." I said, "Let me do for you what I did for Benny Goodman." I said, "I'll put a band together and all this kind of stuff," kind of half joking. Will, wake up. You look like you're dozing.
No, I'm paying attention.
Okay.
I'm not missing a thing, boy.
Okay.
I'm also monitoring the chat for Zoom bombers. You never know.
Okay. So anyway, I was joking about this, but anyway, and I'll try and fast forward the story. Called me on the telephone and said, "You want to know something? I've got a gig at a hotel in New York in between my Carlisle seasons. You mentioned the band. I have some arrangements. Why don't you put together, you know, a horn section and we'll just see what happens." So we go to do the gig. Now, he had arrangements written by a very well-known commercial West Coast arranger whose real name was Richard Hazard. But he went under the name of Dick Hazard. Yeah.
He did some stuff for Mel. I mean, Tomei, yeah.
Right. And they were what you would call hotel band arrangements.
Yeah.
And they were all whole notes and
Footballs. A lot of footballs.
And Bobby told me that the reason he had them written was that if they had a band where he was going to appear somewhere and the band really wasn't that good, anybody could play these charts.
Yeah.
So we played them down and it was good. Then, amazingly, he called. He said, you know what, know something? Would you want to bring a band into the Carlisle for the spring season? This was 1997. And I later found out through Peter Duchin and other people some of the machinations that went into that decision. But regardless, we went in and I started writing arrangements for him. And I made a great error. And the great error I made was, well, Will, I sent you a sound file.
Yes.
Let me preface it by saying I wound up going to his apartment. And he would play the piano. I really want to talk about his piano playing for a moment. And those great shots in Bill's footage where you can see his fingers on the keyboard. And you can see they're kind of flat. And, you know, he really played the piano like a concert pianist. Yeah. He really did, like a classical concert pianist. That's how he played the instrument. It was ferocious.
Right.
And I would go to his apartment and he'd say, what do you think about this song? What do you think about this song? And he would eventually play his arrangement on the piano and I would record it. And then take it home and try and do something with the arrangement. Well, I shared with Will, if you can share it here.
Sure.
A sound file of when I was up at Bobby's house and he wanted to do a tune. And this was the work tape that we made for me to take home and try and figure out. And then I'll tell you the great error I made.
All right. So I will start the share as one does. And this is what you just sent me like a half hour ago, right before we started.
It's the only sound file. I sent you a, yeah. No. That's a YouTube video.
Ah, okay. There's more than one. I don't know if I saw that one, the other one.
It came in after the show started.
Oh, I did not see. All right, keep talking.
Okay. Well, long story short, no pun intended. What happened was that I tried to hip up Bobby's thing because he loved jazz and we had some great players in the band and I thought I was improving some of his piano arrangements and it was kind of like a tough fit. And what I found out eventually was, starting with the second season, was there was no need to try and improve on what he was playing on the piano. Just orchestrate.
Wow.
Kind of what he did on the piano.
Okay, it's ready.
Okay, let's hear it.
I love this song, Vernon Duke.
Yeah.
I'm not sure how it works when you share an audio file.
Okay, we'll skip it then. That's fine.
Wait, no. There must be a way to do this.
Open it in your music thing. Unshare the video.
Right. Unshare the. I've never shared an audio file.
Okay. Now share screen. And at the after you press share screen, right?
Right.
It says something about audio on the
right.
Left.
I got the computer right. Audio.
Then you have to select the program that you're going to play the music from. Listen, we can forget it. I mean.
No, I'll get this.
Okay. So anyway. It's a long way of just saying, folks, that what I learned was that the way that Bobby played the piano was like Billy Strayhorn or Duke Ellington. Everything was in the arrangement, and they were complex, as you'll hear here.
Wait.
Hopefully.
No, I'll...
Dr. Watson, come here. I need you. Okay.
This is doable.
Ah.
I'm going to rest on that. I've got two choruses of lyrics.
Right.
And so the introduction's in E flat, then we go up to F for the band to come in.
So the format is, there's an introduction?
Yeah, with the piano alone.
Piano alone. You're singing. Okay.
It's in the whole 32 bars.
And you want the band in behind you or
oh,
no?
Yes.
Oh, you want the band in behind?
Yes.
Okay.
And then the band then takes an eight chorus, it's pretty well, eight bars of the second chorus, the same key, but a nice big statement, a big brass statement.
Sure.
Because I'm smiling and performing. Yeah. I come back in with the second eight and say it out, and there's a little tag.
For the sake of just getting it done, would you mind just doing just the whole thing from top to bottom just one more time for me?
Hey, Will?
Yes.
We can stop it there.
So anyway, it shall be done.
Yes. So
amazing. Thank you.
Right. So what I'd like to focus in now, and I don't know why I'm shouting. what I'd like to focus in on here is just talk. I did 1,000 one-hour shows with Bobby Short.
No.
And that's
Six
not
years?
And that's not hyperbole. That was over 8 years.
8 years.
And we were at the Carlisle 20 weeks a year.
Wow.
And there were two shows a night. So, you know, 20 weeks is 100 days. And 100 days would be 200 shows. Anyway, so
mathematics, yeah.
Right. So, I want to focus in on some musical things.
He was a fantastic piano player.
And I want to
totally
define
agree.
It. And I want to define it a little bit. He could play two or three different levels of counterpoint at one time. And, you know, we had all kinds of great players in the band. And they would, you know, some of them would come in not knowing that much about Bobby. One thing that we knew in the jazz world was that, believe it or not, Cannonball Adderley had tried to get Orrin Keepnews to sign Bobby for Riverside. Back in the late 50s.
Wow.
You know, not as a jazz pianist, really, but, you know, but just for doing
just
what
Bobby.
He did. You know, he was so well respected. But anyway, so they would come in and do
and
the
didn't
show.
Didn't Miles Davis get the Bye Bye Blackbird arrangement from him, the slow Bye Bye Blackbird?
That could be hyperbole. I don't know. So people would come in to hear him, the guys in the band, and eventually, like, their jaws would start to drop when they started realizing what this guy was doing. And what he was doing was sometimes playing two or three levels of accompaniment at one time on the piano. You know, not just playing one simple thing, but two or three different levels. And you could hear it there almost in some of those chords. Now, if you listen to the chords he was playing, and I know, you know, this is not a music theory arranging class, but even folks who don't play music or read music can understand what I'm talking about. The voicings that he played on the piano, as you could hear there, they were so full, they were so complex that you couldn't go wrong. So eventually, Mark Lopeman and James Chirillo wound up doing a lot of the arranging. I kind of farmed it out to them, although I still continued to write for him. Here's something that you might find interesting, and Bill and your audience, which is that Bobby Short paid the band, even though his contract with the Carlisle only paid for a trio. And he went back to the folk, he said, look, I'm bringing in six horns on top of the bass and the drums. And, you know, is it possible to get some more money for that? They said no. In addition, they had to take out some chairs and tables to seat some of us, so they were losing money. Anyway, Bobby paid out of his own pocket all those years, the band salaries and the union wages and the pension, which he did not have to do. Everybody would have been happy, like, you know, most bands, most jazz bands to this day, their HBO series you watch with famous jazz people playing, they do a one-time payment thing, nothing to the union, nothing to nothing. And Bobby paid, and I figured it out, over $1 million.
Wow.
of his own money to do this. And some of the guys in the band, I hope there's not an earthquake out there, Bill. You okay?
Yeah, no, I had to move.
He's just so shocked to hear that. I remember hearing that at the time, that Bobby was paying for it out of his own pocket. I didn't realize to that extent, but that's amazing.
Well, nobody knew it back then, but I told the story after.
Oh, okay.
But it was over $1 million. And I'll tell you another little anecdote. And just tell me when to stop, Will.
No, keep going.
About how Robbie Scott got the gig with Bobby Short. It's a very odd story. Nobody knows it. But now I'll tell it for the first time live on the Tip Jar Show. Okay. Robbie Scott and I were in a band led by a guy named Bob January. And it was a kind of a nondescript, typical band of the day.
Right.
Barley was the singer. Beverly Peer heard the band one night and came in and asked for Robbie Scott's phone number, his card, because he knew that Bobby was going to need a drummer pretty soon. He liked the way that Robbie played. And Robbie told us this, so we're also thrilled for him. Well, next thing we know, Bobby Short got a new drummer, and it wasn't Robbie Scott. And so everybody was so disappointed, and he was so disappointed. Finally, about 3 or 4 years later, he got the call to go with Bobby Short, and we found out what happened. The story was that Beverly Peer had enjoyed it so much, he brought the card home, and he undressed when he went, got that night, he put the card down, and his wife put her Noxzema jar on top of Robbie Scott's card. And it wasn't until she ran out of the Noxzema, and we'll let that go, you know, many years later, when she went to throw it away, and she said, honey, there's something at the bottom of this jar, and it was Robbie Scott's card. And that's how he got the gig.
Oh, wow.
Right. It sounds like, you know, it's a crazy story. But
Bobby
anyway.
Had his own big band for a while, sort of like a Vince Giordano kind of thing. With Chuck mm-hmm. Were you in that? You must have been
no,
in that.
No.
Chuck Wilson, I remember, was in. Trying to remember well. But yeah.
Yeah. So anyway, so that's the story. I could talk, you know, forever about Bobby, but I'll just tell you that looking over us in my apartment here, I don't have that many pictures up. I'm not the type like with pictures of myself and all that stuff. But we do have this wonderful photo, which
nice.
Was taken at Bobby's house in Mougins in France the summer before he passed.
Aww.
And we were on vacation, and he kept saying all throughout the years at the Carlisle, if you guys are ever in the south of France, you have to say hello. You know, well, sure, of course, I'm in the south of France. I'll say hello. Well, we wound up in the south of France, and we visited George Wein, actually, in France, that same thing. I'm a big, you know. But anyway, so Bobby was very important personally to me in so many ways, and just, you know, whether... You know, and I also worked with Sylvia Sims, you know, for a long time. And like Sylvia, like Frank, like Tony, you know, Bobby was, what's the word, sui generis?
Sui generis.
Right. He was one of a kind. He had his own world. And, of course, it was captured in that wonderful video that Bill did. He had his own world. Now, the funny thing is almost like Ethel Merman. He's like Ethel Merman in a way and very unlike Ethel Merman in another way. My grandfather saw Ethel Merman back in the 30s, and he loved her, all this kind of stuff. I couldn't stand her because I only saw her on television with, you know, and it was, you know, she was too big, as we all know, right?
Yeah.
She was
yeah.
too big for the screen. She,
yeah. she overwhelmed the medium. Yeah.
Right. Now, Bobby, in a certain way, of course, his great venue was at the Carlisle, about 100 people. But even as he performs and, you know, it's not how he performed on that TV show. It's how he did it every night at the Carlisle. It was big.
Yeah.
It was big. And it was
bigger than life. Yeah.
It was the rolled eyes. And it was the all this stuff that really doesn't, you know what I mean? Like, it doesn't translate into a small thing. It's very funny. I'll tell you just one more magic moment here and a funny anecdote that may bring us to the world of Anton Webern. Which is that I wrote an arrangement of, which we recorded, of Street of Dreams. And I used to love the way he sang on the Street of Dreams. Now, the first season that we were at the Carlisle, we had the three reeds over on one side. And on the other side of the piano, on the other side of the bass, were the three brass. So we were separated by, I don't know, by 10 or 12 feet. Now, I had written an arrangement that had trombone and a bass clarinet playing a pretty intricate harmony thing behind Bobby as he sang Street of Dreams. Now, if they were sitting next to each other and you heard them play like this, it would make perfect sense. But if you were sitting near the bass clarinet or near the trombone, it sounded like Wozzeck. Okay, it sounded like atonal music. Right. It had nothing to do with anything. And for the whole season, we still kept playing the damn thing, but it was so funny, you know. But we finally recorded it. And I don't know where to start or where to stop. I miss him dearly. And like Bill's show in the 70s and 80s, which I kid you not, because I was a college, you know, I had a lot of time. I was an unemployed musician. I would go to the tapings and seeing Bobby at the Carlisle, not to get nostalgic about it, but it was a moment. And it was a moment, and it's the world that formed me and my generation and Will, who's slightly younger than me. And I treasure it all the more now that it's gone. And being able to share it with Bill especially.
You told me a cute story.
Bill's muted there.
Oh, sorry. Well, you unmute Bill.
Yeah, but it's true.
You should be unmuted now. Yeah.
Me?
Yeah. Yeah. But did you want to say something?
I am. No.
Oh, okay.
I have to leave soon. But
I know. I'm amazed you stayed this long. You have to walk Spike. I know. Spike needs a walkie.
That's right.
But I remember Lauren told me a story when Bobby was you know, when this was still happening. For some reason, you had to sub out a gig, and then at the last minute, you could make it. So Bobby invited you to watch the show, and you had never seen the show with the band, obviously, because you were in the band. And you told me you had a whole different take on Bobby as a performer, seeing him at that point, what he was doing with his face, what he's doing with his expressions, you know, his visual cues to the audience. And you said it was like a whole, you know, and having been in Bobby's band for years at that point, and then seeing him live, again, you learned something about him that you hadn't realized, which I thought was bad. Yeah. You told me that. This is what you told me, like, God, it must have been 20 years ago.
Yeah. No, it was incredible. And I also want to second what Bill said and you said about Eric. Oh, yes, and I will tell you something. I've told this to Eric, and I think he thought that maybe I was blowing smoke up his nose when I told him, but it's literally true, which is that, you know, all different kinds of people came in to see Bobby. Jesse Norman would come in and just all these people. You know, I had this weird experience one night where I was sitting as his musical director. You know, he was facing this way with the piano, and I was like this. Across directly from my eyesight, looking right into what seemed to be my eyes all night, was Nancy Reagan. And I said, just say no. But anyway, but getting back to Eric, I remember two distinct occasions, there may have been more, where it was the second show on a quiet weeknight. Now, Bobby was the kind of pro. Like, I first had this experience when I played in a lounge act opposite Sam Butera and the Witnesses, and also the Traineers, if that name
rings. Oh, wow, we love the Traineers.
And we were in the lounge at Resorts International 40 years ago, and it would be 3:45 a.m., and the Traineers would come out, or Sam Butera would come out, and do their whole act, just like this. And I was with the young band, and we thought they were so silly, you know. Why they, you know... Stupid. Okay, well, what's the point? Bobby always, of course, put on his show, no matter if there was two people there. In fact, some nights, the guy at the Carlisle would say, hey, Bobby, you know what, there's only, we had a party canceled, and there's only, 13 people. We can tell him that the show's canceled. He would insist on doing the show. Well, anyway, I remember two distinct times when Eric came in to see Bobby, and Bobby not only did his regular show, but I knew because I was there every goddamn night. He put the pedal down on the floor and did things he didn't usually do and pushed and created like a real show. Whereas for that show, I know that he would have just taken it down a little bit. And how much he respected Eric as a musician. And I'll tell you, because I work with both of them, that, you know, I don't, and it's really an indictment of the Carlisle, but that's a whole nother story. You know, that there really is nobody with the intelligence, the irony, and the great piano playing and great chord changes of what Eric does with Babs. They're absolutely unique. And Bobby knew that. And I'm telling you that he knew it.
It's getting such Kanakas. Great story. And on Yom Kippur, too. Yeah.
One more thing.
And I want you to introduce that video. What's the story behind that?
Okay. Bye, Bill.
I'm going to leave. Bye-bye. Thank you. Say hello to Eric. And I want to when I first went to see Bobby with the band there, it brought the level of elegance up even higher. To be in a room that size with those instruments playing unamplified, it was just unamplified was the key, man.
Yes.
So I've been to places where the room is like the size of my apartment, and they're blowing through speakers and stuff like that. I love, anyway, thank you for this. It's been a great pleasure. And I send you love. I look forward to seeing you. Stay healthy and well, and count your blessings. Bobby was among our many blessings we can count.
Amen. Take care, Bill.
Yeah. Man. No, but I think it's another thing wrong with the world is, for whatever it was, 8 years that you did that, there's not really a great video. I mean,
I have to tell you, I spoke to D.A. Pennebaker. You know who that was.
Seriously?
Right?
I thought you were making a joke.
No.
We're going to show the D.A. Pennebaker Dave Lambert film tomorrow. Really?
No.
What happened? How'd that go?
I spoke to Pennebaker and Maisels, actually.
Oh, wow. That's two great names to drop.
About doing a documentary about Bobby, about his life. And Baker and his wife, or you know, who worked with him for many years, or I assume it was his wife, but this woman that he did all his things with, they met with him, they came down. I'm trying to remember who it was that introduced me to him. But anyway, they may even have shot a little bit, but what happened was Bobby, frankly, did not want to open up about his private life. And they said that they could not do a documentary film about him if he was going to be from that generation of people who didn't want to talk about their private lives. And that was too bad. And so consequently, it never got made. So getting to the video, I bought in my little Amateurville video recorder on several nights over several years and would put it on the bank, on the thing behind me. I was sitting on a banquette, and behind me, you know, was the ridge up here. And I would just put the machine on there and record the show. So the show is from the vantage point of how I saw Bobby at the piano. The audio is screwed up because, you know, you hear a lot of saxophones and trombones, and you see Bobby back there. But they are great documents of a night at the Carlisle, and there are many of them. And you see him do his rap, and you see him say to the audience, you know, you look wonderful, you look rich, you look smart, and we want to thank all of you for being here tonight. You're also wonderful. Thank you. And like, I mean, he was such a genius. I mean, he played that audience like a violin. You know what I mean? I mean, you
but
know,
he was sincere, too. It wasn't all.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. I mean, I was putting like it up because, you see, but that's another thing about Bobby, which is the African-American guy in a room full of white, rich white people, for the most part, singing songs that were never intended to be sung by black people about a white world of Cole Porter and Noel Coward. And then ultimately, he became the arbiter. Who's in?
I rest my
case. Out?
Right.
Right?
Exactly.
And of course he was aware of that. And of course Ralph Ellison and other people who were big fans of his were aware of it. And this is a whole nother level of, not of irony necessarily, but a whole other level to start to approach who Bobby Short was, what he represented, and what happened in that damn room every night with all those people, in which on many nights he was probably the only black person in there. Except for maybe
Beverly Pierce, yeah, and the musician.
Well, Beverly wasn't there when I was there.
Oh, okay.
But still, so, you know, that you can't ignore that. That's a fact. And so even like when I was imitating him poorly, going, you look wonderful, he was just like Ellington.
Yeah.
And Cole Porter and Noel Coward.
Right.
He was double dipped in irony and sophistication. And much more than it appeared to be on the surface. So anyway, enough of my lecture.
So how much of the do you want? This is a 21-minute clip. Let me know.
No, because I'm dying to hear from Eric, actually.
Right.
Skip the video and go to Eric. But if you want to watch it, just show 3 or 4 minutes of it. You'll just see a little snippet of Bobby live, not knowing he's being recorded. Just one night of 1,000 nights at the Carlisle.
Yay. Just tell me when to, you can tell me when to stop. Which sure. people are always doing. Oh, wait, how do I? I have to. Okay, I have to move the thing here. Wait, you have the title?
He did so many wonderful things. And there's a lot of humor there, too. You know what I mean?
Oh, yeah.
I'll have to tell you the story sometime about the time that we were talking with. Anyway, okay. All right, here we go. That's the band that we had. Really fine players. And, you know, playing together.
So we'll start with our tenor saxophonist and clarinetist, Mr. Ken Toplowski. Playing the alto saxophone, Mr. Lauren Schoenberg. Our baritone saxophonist, Mr. Carl Ramaghi. Mr. Bobby Pring is our trombonist. Our trumpet player is Mr. John Eckert. And Mr. Virgil Jones. At the drums, Mr. Klaus Suonsari. And playing the bass fiddle, Mr. Frank Tate. In Harlem, there's someone waiting there who makes it seem like heaven up in Harlem. I don't want your Dixie. You can keep your Dixie. There's nothing down in Dixie that can take the place of my old Harlem. Harlem has the sobbing sky, there in my baby's smile, I idolize my baby's eyes, her classy uptown style. Harlem moved to China, there'd be nothing finer than to stow away on a plane someday. Drop me off in Harlem. Be nothing finer than to stow away on a plane someday and let them drop me off in Harlem.
That video is up on my YouTube channel somewhere, so people can watch the whole thing.
But I'm glad
back a lot of great memories.
I'm glad you had an Ellington tune, because that's the other aspect of Bobby I wanted to mention. That yes, Cole Porter, yes, Noel Coward, but he was fiercely proud of his African American heritage, and he was just as much about Duke Ellington and Ethel Waters and Ivy Anderson, Bessie Smith, and he always did like one real gut bucket blues, whether it was Gimme a Pigfoot or Empty Bed Blues. To me, Bobby Short was one of the great blues singers. I put him in a class with, Howling Wolf or Muddy Waters or anybody. I love the way he sang the blues.
Me too. You know, we had a meeting with Ahmet Erdogan where Bobby was going to make a blues record with Lenny Kravitz, because Lenny Kravitz's parents met at Bobby's apartment.
Oh.
And so Bobby was like Lenny Kravitz's uncle, so to speak. And
I did an event once. I don't know if it was a clip joint. It was before clip joint, but Phoebe Jacobs came by with Lenny Kravitz's father. And I'm like, wow, Lenny Kravitz's father? Phoebe Jacobs and Lenny Kravitz's father.
Right. So we had a meeting, and I'll tell you a story now, because they're both gone, and it doesn't reflect badly on either one of them. I didn't tell the story while either one was still around, but I think that they would have get a kick out of it. So we were talking about this album, and Ahmet was there, and at the end, Bobby was a little nervous about it, because, you know, he knew Lenny Kravitz was a big star, and Bobby was going to do the blues, and Bobby said, you know, I really don't know, I'm not sure that this is going to work, Ahmet, I'm sorry. And Ahmet, who spoke, I'm going to imitate the way he spoke, he said, Bobby, don't worry about it, man. He said, man, this record's going to be the bomb, man. It's going to be the bomb. Bobby said, a bomb? The record's going to bomb? I don't know what you mean. To which Ahmet said, Bobby, that's black talk. You wouldn't understand.
That's
a true story. It really happened.
I want to hear you do an imitation of Benny Goodman and Ahmet Erdogan. No, Benny Goodman and Bobby Short talking to each other.
Anyway. So there you go. So that's the story.
So, Eric, are you out there? Let's bring on Eric. Yay. Wait, where is Eric? Oh, I can find him. Wait, I can use my... Or maybe he's under Barbara. Wait, he's under Fasano.
Hate to disappoint you, but it's not Barbara Fasano.
Oh.
And, well, what a night. What a night, and the beautiful things that have been said about a very special guy, by special guys. And it's just, you know, I cannot compete with these anecdotes, especially Lauren's anecdotes. So I don't do voices, but beautiful, beautiful night. I mean, I can tell you some things I observed at the Carlisle all the years I went, if you would like, or whatever you'd like
for you. You first became a Bobby fan through records, right? Through your parents' record collection?
My parents met in the village, and they didn't have a lot of money, but they courted in New York, and they saw Mabel Mercer and Bobby Short at cheaper places than the Carlisle. And they had the records. And I think they went to the Carlisle a couple of times, but they certainly didn't take me. I mean, my mother's was very clear. This is a room for millionaires. We're not millionaires. So they went a couple of times. But yes, my mother would buy Bobby Short on the East Side, which is a great raucous live album, and of course his big hit Cole Porter double LP set. And then he was appearing in our neck of the woods, Lauren, at the Ori de New Year Auditorium in Hackensack. And I was 16, and we went to that. Of course, It was sensational. I think I'd seen him on with the Boston Pops prior to that. I think I saw him with Arthur Fiedler in the mid-70s. This was going on the late 70s. And by then, I didn't know what I was going to do in my life yet, but I went to school. I put up shows, put up cabaret shows where I would MC and play for the people, sing one song or two songs. And that was at George Washington University. Then I transferred to NYU, and I read, I think, Marie Brenner's piece about the Carlyle in New York Magazine, where it mentioned a bar. I didn't know there was a bar. So I was an undergraduate at NYU, and I would put on the blue suit, and not having much to do, you know, not really interested in going to the Palladium, I went up to Cafe Carlyle and nursed the ginger ale for the first set, and Domingo, the bartender, would let me stay for the second set for the cost of another ginger ale. And I saw both sets, and eventually Bobby got to recognize me, I guess. And you know, it touches me so much what Lauren has said, because that means a lot to me. And I'm hope in a very minor, modest way, I'm keeping something going that obviously meant a lot to him. And one personal story is that, well, also Will Friedwald changed my life, I must say, because he introduced me to more jazz oriented ways of doing the material, which has been another big influence on me, for which I always will be grateful. But the first time I ever got reviewed in the New York Times 20 years ago, I got a phone message. That was very terse, but very sweet. It was just, "This is Bobby Short, star. Thank you."
Aww.
Click. And like Duke Ellington, you never know the levels. But I think he was saying, he was mentioned in the review. Bobby was mentioned in the review. So he's saying, you seem to be doing something that means a lot to me, and thank you for that.
Hey, Will, can I ask Eric a question?
Yes. Of course. That's a question right there, but it's to me. But yes, of course.
You said once when we were talking about Bobby, you said that he gave you a life or something along those lines. Yeah. And I didn't get a chance to ask you exactly what you meant by that. But I mean, that's a hell of a statement.
The Bobby Short world, as you described it, that world that he just created and willed to be and such a success at it and so brilliant at it. And of course, that appealed to me, growing up in suburban New Jersey, and you just see that the innuendos, the lyrics, I didn't ultimately fully understand at 9 and 10, but I saw something I had to learn more about, and of course his joy, the joy he communicated, and you could argue as a jazz musician, you know, he broke a few rules by his accelerando on just one of those things. He just get faster and faster and faster. And I'm sure that was not his training to do that, even though it's one of the things that makes him unique. But I have to think, Lauren, see if you agree. And my suspicion is when you are performing for the privileged, pampered people, they are not necessarily going to be the most attentive and polite audience. And you find your tricks in show business to hold on to them. And that might be one of the tricks. Just the energy just surges and surges and surges, and the tempo races. Do you think that's possible?
I have a question.
Hmm.
Don't conductors do accelerandos with orchestras?
Of course they do. Yes.
Okay. So Bobby.
So much for this theory.
Just one of them. No, I'm just saying. But I'm agreeing with you. You know. But I have another question for you. Well, I'm sorry, but I've always.
No, it's great. I'm digging it.
Something that you share with Bobby, and I've noticed it because I've seen you play, you know, in crowded rooms, and I've stayed for the last set sometimes when there were just a handful of us there. You attack the piano with gusto every time you sit down at that damn thing, and I noticed the same thing with Bobby. And I've always wanted to ask you, like, was that something that you had innately yourself, or was that something that you noticed about him? Because like that recording I played of him in his apartment, I mean, my God, it was just me and him and the dog, and he's sitting there playing the damn piano. You heard it, right?
So complex, so thick,
right?
So thought out and as you said, the counterpoints, the other themes going on.
But just the sheer thing, because I've just noticed that you do the same thing. When you sit down to the piano, I have never heard you pussyfoot. You know, like you just play that, you went tag, you know.
I think that came later on in life, because I got more confident being myself on stage for people and became a better piano player. You and Will have both known me long enough that I'm sure there were times when I was tentative, more tentative than I am now. You just keep working, and if you love what you do, you'll keep at it and get better. And I don't know if it's directly as a result. I think Ellington is another big influence on me in piano, also because he is so percussive. And so I think it's a lot of people, what Bobby would call a mélange, but obviously Bobby is right up there at the top for me of influences in repertoire and piano style, I guess, and well, being an entertainer, knowing how to hold their attention and be amusing and yes, ironic at times, and you say it, but you don't quite mean it, and some people will get it. That's something that Barbara says to me often is, what I love is you just keep going, and some of the people, the hardcore, will get it immediately and laugh, and some people, it'll be a little, not sure, but they're gonna be interested enough to, you know, and they will catch up, you know, whether it's a lyric or just what you say between tunes. So let me tell you a couple of my favorite choice things that he would say standing up, you know, after the first three or four songs. That's another thing I learned. Don't talk after the first song, which people in our cabaret rooms do much too often. Just hit them with a big opener, maybe two, and then I think he used to do three, like either Gershwin or Rodgers and Hart in a row, and there would certainly be the first ballad. Oh, and of course, no one has mentioned he did his own lights.
Yes.
He had a little thing back there, a little dimmer, and you'd never notice. I mean, who was going to do it if not he? And he's reaching behind, and when he's going to sing Easy to Remember, he's got to turn down the lights.
You know? And I just have to say, just interject, sometimes he would even look surprised that the light came on.
That's funny. Yeah. What an actor. Well, actually, one of my stories has to do with Easy to Remember. I don't know if this may be before your time, you know, before the band, although I know he did it up until the end, but he would describe Mississippi, the Bing Crosby movie, and among the things he would say is, lovely scenery, Georgian mansions, juniper bushes, and oodles of cheap labor. I'm sure some people had no idea what he meant by that. He also said, good evening. This is the fourth night of the seventh week of our 33rd fall season in this saloon. That's a lot of cotton picking.
I never heard that.
And you all speak French. You're all very rich. We hold these truths to be self-evident. Fantastic stuff.
But Eric, I don't. You send me a couple of clips that you wanted to show. Is there anything you want to play next? I am going to play something.
I'm sure you'll pick the right one.
Well, I'm going to play Call Me Mister. That's the earliest film of Bobby, and very, right. Very, 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 very
different. He's unbilled, as I recall.
Yeah, right? But boy. I saw this when I was a kid, and even then I knew it was Bobby. Unmistakable. Where did I? Oh, here it is. Here we go.
You know what's funny? With
all right, fellas, on stage. Come on. Come on. Hey, the boys are knocked out. Let's go home. How long do you want to rehearse them? They'll be singing it in their sleep. They are singing it in their sleep. We're just getting it the way we want it.
Okay,
just one more time, fellas. That's all, I promise you. And this time we'll do it with all the business and props. Hit it, Pete. There goes the introduction, boys. Are you ready with a steam, Joe? Okay. How about the wires, Jimmy?
Train is the going home train, this train is the going home train, this train is the going home train, never more to roam train, this train is the going home train, this train.
Hit that, she's going.
This click-clack, 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 she's blowing. This click-clack, click-clack, home click-clack, no slowing. This train is a going home train.
This train, let me off at my station, porter, please.
Let me off at my station, porter, please.
Got me pay, sure, I'm looking for a girl who knows home cooking.
This train is a going home, this train.
Bound for Washington, New Orleans, Kansas City, Siwash Junction, Wichita Falls, North Flat, Seattle.
Oh, and southeast, west, or north, and up and down and back and forth.
Oh, this train, get aboard, get aboard, get aboard, get aboard, get aboard. Gonna raise me up a family, have some kids that all will look like me. If we guys have our say, we'll throw these clothes away.
This train, get aboard, get aboard, get aboard, get aboard, get aboard.
Did our share for liberty. Did our share for liberty. But the guys who would destroy it, now we're going back to enjoy it. This train. Casey Jones, lean on that throttle stick.
Roger.
Make it fast. I wanna get there quick. Engineer, please make it run.
Wanna see that old familiar engine on. This train is a going home train. This train, this train is a going home train. This train, this train is a going home train. Never more a wrong train. This train. This train
is the going home train. This train is the going home train. Going home, going home.
There's a fragment that's here today, and they call it Charlie. A different fragment that thinks your way, yeah, they call it Charlie, kind of free, kind of wild. Charlie, kind of fragrant that's gonna stay, and it's here now. Charlie!
Charlie, by Revlon, a most original fragrance.
Let's do you do something to me, or since that.
Look, here's Giuliani.
Who does it?
Which one of those three is gonna do it? You gonna do them?
I don't know. You wanna do it?
You wanna do it? Wanna do it?
I love
hers?
It.
And Karen.
Together?
We'll try it again.
I don't know the verse. Go on.
I was mighty blue. Thought my life was through. Then the heavens opened and I gazed at you. Would you tell me, dear, why will you appear? Something happens to me and the strangest feeling runs through me.
You do something to me. Something that simply mystifies me. Tell me, why should it be? You have the power to hypnotize me. Let me live beneath your spell. Do that voodoo that you do so well. That nobody else can do.
And that was a hit from that.
Great.
Was that from the Frenchman?
Yes, 50 million Frenchmen.
Hey, so a little collage of various Bobby. Eric, where are you? There you are. Oh, we must unmute you. Wait, how do we unmute? Unmute.
There we are.
There you are. There you be.
Oh, Julie Wilson, God bless her. Karen Akers, Larry King in his shirt sleeves.
Do you know anything about that commercial? I mean, so many people remember. I remember that vividly with Shelley Hack later on Charlie's Angels, there in her shiny construction worker suit, it looks like. You know,
I do know that Bobby got a little tired probably of being, hey, Charlie, on the street. I mean, it was what he became best known for several years, I guess, in the late 70s and 80s.
But certainly says something that he was that visible. You know, he was hired for a national.
He was the arbiter of elegance. And so, of course, he also did Gloria Vanderbilt Bottoms, They're the Top.
Oh, boy, I never saw that. Got to find that.
For blue jeans.
I remember when I first met you, this is
1983, I think.
Maybe something like that, when Tower opened. And you were already, you were much more of a Bobby fan than I was. Of course, I came around. But you wrote him I don't know if it was a fan letter, but sort of a combination fan and not just fan for fan's sake, but looking for sort of professional advice. And he graciously responded, and you were, that was kind of the beginning, right? You said,
yes.
I want to do what you do, which
That's
is basically
right.
Dizzy Gillespie said about Louis Armstrong, know him, know me. And John Pizzarelli says about Nat King Cole, he is why I do what I do. So I think that, you know, you're in good company. Hey.
Lots of other musical influences, largely many of them brought to me by you. Bobby was kind of the first, and my parents also had Fats Waller records and Fred Astaire, you know, his Brunswick records of his movie songs. So they were also, and Noel Coward at Las Vegas, which I joke about. But I think Bobby made it was more the most accessible of them all, because I guess I love the fact that he worked in New York all the time. I love that he spent most of his time. That may not have been his desire. I'm sure he wanted to be more of a name and do even more high-profile gigs with orchestras and stuff, and he did a lot of that. But I love the fact that he was able to have that place to hang his hat and you know, one of the greatest rooms that's ever been invented.
Well, you know, it's like the world was you know, going to chaos all around, and the idea that somebody singing Cole Porter and Rodgers and Hart could be that high profile that late in the game. I mean, this is the era, you know, when we were in high school, they were listening to the Ramones. I mean, it was nine generations after Sinatra and Bing Crosby. I know it sounds to the younger people, they think we're ancient now, but really this was years and years and years after the.
And he never changed lyrics. He'd never say, and South Pacific is a terrific show, they say. He would give you, you know, Peggy Hopkins Joyce.
We'll take to AB's Irish show. Right.
Can I add something here? You know, it was also the era of The Sting, the movie.
Right, right.
And I think that, like, that was 72. And so I think that kind of launched a wave of nostalgia.
A ragtime, yeah.
Or, well,
it's funny, he says Treemonish has been done to death in Bill's interview. Treemonish has never been done. Plus, I mean, it doesn't belong on Black Broadway because it was not a Broadway musical. But it's just funny that he mentioned it in that context, because, you know, Treemonish, if there's one show that's not been done to death, it's it's legendarily unperformed, in fact. But
I have a question, or not a question, but I would like you guys and everyone on the broadcast, if you can do this, Will, either I can share a screen or you can look at the email that I just sent you. But I uncovered Bobby on film in 1947 in a Hollywood film.
Okay.
Well.
Yes. And it's a clip I put up on Facebook several years ago. I was watching a 1947 Michael Curtiz film called The Unsuspected. And there's a band playing in a nightclub scene. And there's just a quick pan across the band. And if that's not Bobby Shore playing the piano, I'll eat my hat. And you guys would know better than anybody. So can you do it, Will?
Yeah, I'm going to try to screw. You guys talk while I try to work this out here.
Fascinating. Okay,
there it is. Oh, there it is.
Yeah.
Very quick pan. It's 13 seconds.
Right. So you maybe show it twice. But
I will
if that's
this.
Not Bobby, then I'm I'll
Queen
eat
of
my
Sheba.
Hat.
I know, right?
You would be 20. You'd be 23 or
yeah,
so.
Yeah.
Quite young.
Yeah.
Wait, let me.
Beautiful girl, but not like that. So I guess that was his nightclub version, you know, in four of that song. He did it in its original 3/4 on one of his early records.
And most of the Island on the West Indies is on one of the first two albums. Most all those songs are on the early Atlantic albums.
Yes.
Which are so great. I mean, the later Atlantic albums too, they all are great. Although I would say the 50s, those albums and the stuff after he gets to the Carlisle, there's a marked difference, although both are great, you know? Don't you think?
And happily, he got to make records with Lauren's ensemble. Not enough.
Yeah, we did one with the. What happened was we recorded one live at the Carlisle, and there was something with the sound. I have the music on my computer, but something happened with the sound, so we went into the studio and did it. No. And then we did another one that was with a small big band, I guess you would call it, like maybe three or four saxophones and two trombones and three trumpets, which is good. Yeah. But I know what you mean, Will, like about those Atlantic records from the 50s. There's like a classic quality to them. Yeah, it's true. Yeah. But God, he has so much energy. I mean, it's right. I mean, you could, it's like Johnny Carson said about Sam Ervin. I remember during Watergate where he said, you know, there's a power shortage. They should just wire up Sam Ervin's eyebrows. But, you know, Bobby has so much energy there. Oh my God. It's frightening almost. Yeah.
And also the bits that you don't. Yeah. This is why we do Clip Joint, frankly. Bobby doing a silent movie accompaniment, watching an imaginary screen. How in the world did he even think of that? I mean, it's just ingenious. And again, you know.
And pressing down the pedal, as Lauren
said. Yeah, exactly.
Yes.
Yeah. And I just love, you know, those faces he made. You know, it's just.
Arm gestures.
So him. It's unique. Yeah.
Yeah, there'll never be another Bobby Short, but a lot of people would like to be and have been talked about that way, and it's as fruitless as another Frank Sinatra, and that's okay.
Yeah, we're lucky to have one. We're lucky
that's
to have even
right.
one. Exactly. Yeah.
Funny story about the Carlisle. I mean, there's a million of them, but one was that there were big debates when they were going to raise the cover charge from $90 to $100, and it was you know. Big discussions. I wasn't part of them, but I'd hear about them from Bobby or from Barbara Carroll or whomever.
You weren't a Schmendrick there?
I was head Schmendrick. But anyway, and I just remember at the same time, this is ridiculous. Can you imagine a couple, this conversation? Honey, let's go to the Carlisle tonight. We can't go. Why? Well, it's $100, you know, 90 was fine, but $100. I mean, it was going to make such a big difference. I'll tell you something else about the Carlisle. And Will, you're just going to have to pull the plug here because I'll never stop. But it was about the the busboys, what they call busboys. They weren't busboys; they were busmen. Some of those guys had been there for, you know, since Coolidge was presidential.
You know, Coolidge, I mean, called it the New York White House. Right?
But what happened?
Warren Harding called it the New York White House. Right.
But what happened was when we went out to play Catalina's in L.A., which was the first gig I did with Bobby that wasn't at the Carlisle. I mean, an extended gig. We were there for a weekend or two weekends. You began to notice what artists, the staff at the Carlisle was, because they were serving dinner, they were cleaning plates, the bartender, and you didn't hear a god darn noise during one of Bobby's shows at the Carlisle. Very rarely would you hear a tinkle sound. We got to the, you know, to the jazz club, and all of a sudden, and plates clamoring and all this kind of stuff. There was a guy who worked at the Carlisle, little guy, nice guy, and he had a scam going. His thing was, and he told me about it, he'd find a sucker, and he'd go like, and he was... He wore the white outfit. He was a busboy, you know, but he was older. He'd say, "Sir, I noticed that you smoke cigars." He said, "I have some of John F. Kennedy's cigars from the basement." And he would sell these things, man. He'd sell them to these people for $100 a pop.
Oh, my God.
Bobby had another thing that he could do where in between sets, I know Eric knows this, you know, he would sit in that lounge area, and it had a name. I can't remember the name of it, but... He would sit there, you know, kind of looking, I don't know how to describe it, like on the one hand, he looked kind of approachable. People would come up and say something. But on the other hand, he also radiated kind of like a... So, you know, it was really wonderful how he mediated. Like, you know, he wasn't your friend, you know, he was still Bobby Short waiting like this. Well, anyway, I'd be sitting there talking with him, and he could spot somebody 30 yards away who was looking for the bathroom. long before they came within range. And they'd walk across because the bathroom was hard to find. It was not, there was no sign, and it was off in the back somewhere. And all he would do is, as they walked by, he'd go.
Very, and you're probably the only one who ever noticed that.
Yeah, yeah.
Good time.
Well, Will, you say there's another, maybe not tonight, maybe you've got to wrap it up, but you've got another Hefner appearance. That's very exciting. Did not know that. But boy, there was a lot I didn't know. And the fantastic rehearsal recording that Lauren brought. And of course, we've got to thank Bill for memorializing that era before, you know, certainly before I went to Cafe Carlisle to see that world in those days. Fantastic.
And they smoked in there back in the early days.
Oh, yes.
Smoked. And it's interesting how Gene Bach, I heard from Gene about how they engineered Bobby to get this gig. And I asked Bobby about it. I don't think it's in his book. And for those of you out there, you should definitely read Black and White Baby.
Yeah, the first book.
Because he really did write it. It's his. Yeah. If you knew him and you read the book, it's him. But George Fayer, I guess, was his name. Was the piano, he was from Austria or something, I forget where he was from, but anyway, and the story was that he was taking off for the summer or something like that, and Bobby got the gig, but what I heard was that Gene Bach and, well, you know, Bobby was a favorite of the Duke and Duchess of Windsor in the 50s, and they were big sponsors of his, and we'll let that go for a moment, but they were huge, and supposedly in the 50s, if they had a party in New York, you know, if they... You know, if you were invited, you know, if the local Bund meeting, you know, wasn't the same night, you know.
Oh, that Duke of Windsor. Yeah.
Right, right, you know.
Lovely fella.
Right. But Bobby was their favorite entertainer. And that's how he really got a leg up with the high society.
Yeah.
Was because of Duke and Duchess of Windsor. But anyway, Gene Bach and people like that somehow conspired in a non-pejorative sense of the word conspired. To get Bobby that gig, and when he got in there to show up and show the flag and keep going. And Bobby said, you know, he never thought that it would last. I mean, you know.
35 years, right?
Yeah.
And well, George Fayer, there was no cover charge when George Fayer was there holding court. And I think they split the year for a while or something. Mm-hmm. And George Fayer got hired at the Stanhope and left. He didn't like sharing. And so for Bobby, they upped it from $0, 0 cents, to $2.50. And the ladies of Madison Avenue were outraged. $2.50. And as James Gavin says in his book, Intimate Nights, it was one of the rare cases where a serious artist was there to entertain the rich and pampered. You know,
really?
This was a very different thing. George Fayer, I did see him at the Waldorf.
I saw him at the Waldorf, too, yeah.
Yeah. He was, you know, that charming European thing, and he sang a lot of the Chevalier songs. But it was, you know, is just what the speed of those people. Bobby was obviously a change. He was a serious guy with a very interesting palette of material, and demanded attention.
You guys will appreciate this, and then we're going to wrap up in a little bit. But Michael Feinstein can do an impression of George Fayer playing the piano.
Uh-oh.
In which he'll play an American Gershwin song, say, and wherever there's a blue note or a jazzy note,
he
eliminates it. He corrects it and makes it a
very
proper,
funny.
Proper European note. He raises it up a step or something. So, yeah.
And the ladies of Madison Avenue had no idea, I imagine.
Yes. But before Bobby, the Carlisle was that kind of a place, but it was not world famous. It was not a destination. Bobby really made it into something.
By choice. Yeah. You know? It was off the beaten path, and they liked it that way.
Exactly. Okay. Yeah, Bobby made it much more mainstream. And he made it into this incredible bastion. You know, this was the place you would go in New York. Like I say, where everybody else, you know, was at CBGB's. Bobby was playing Noel Coward and Cole Porter, and he was the only game in town. And he really made that work to his advantage, you know?
And then, you know, he was kind of immortalized in, is it Annie
and her sisters?
Right.
Annie and her sisters.
Right, which is, you don't deserve Bobby Short.
Oh, I gotta watch that again.
Yeah. Yeah. But he, I can go on forever.
There's one kind of
honesty. We could.
Let me see if I can find it. There's one, another one from the Larry King show that we really ought to end
I'll tell you something else, Will, just while you're looking for it, was how beloved he was by the musicians who played for him. And trust me, you know, playing for a name act or whatever you want to call it.
Jazz musicians can be jaded, I understand.
Well, they're treated pretty crappily by a lot of people that they back. And Bobby, as you saw in that little clip that I showed, every show he would introduce the guys in the band and all that.
Claire Daly, remember? He got so excited when he had a female musician. He would say the gentlemen and ladies of the ensemble. He was just delighted. I guess Claire was a sub for Carl, right? And I remember being there when Claire was playing, and Bobby was just absolutely delighted to have a female instrumentalist in the ensemble. And he made a point to give her a special introduction.
Can I tell you another funny story?
Please do.
And I'll stop. This is just, it's not about Bobby, but it's about Bobby Short's world. There's a wonderful young female trombone player who came to New York. She's left. Her name is Britta Langshan. And she was really, really good. And she came to New York, and she was looking for work. And I loved the way she played. And, you know, we had two trombones. We had Eddie Burt and Bobby Pring. And, by the way, one other thing I just want to mention about Bobby was when he paid the union dues and the pension and health and welfare, that, you know, frankly, in that band, Virgil Jones, Eddie Burt, and Bobby Pring are gone now. Yeah. They were older then. Their later years were so different because they had the pension that Bobby paid, and they had the health care coverage that he paid for through the union. And it made such a difference in their lives. I mean, it was really amazing. Well, anyway, Bobby and Eddie never took off. It was, you know, they were there all the time. It was a very well-paying gig. And as Bill Boggs said, and I forgot about it, I think it was the last gig in New York, steady gig, for a horn section, 20 weeks a year, with no amplification. There wasn't one mic. The only mic was for Bobby's microphone, and maybe the bass player had a little amp on. But all the sound of the music of the horns was all acoustic.
Natural blend.
Yeah, it was crazy. Well, anyway, so Britta comes in to sub, and she's about 20 years old, and she's all excited, and she's going to wear her tuxedo, and she says, I don't know if I... You know, I said, just be quiet. I said, you're great. It'll be wonderful. You know, we're happy to have you. So she comes, and she does the show, and she was fine. And in the middle of the show, there was a plunger trombone solo on one of the Duke Ellington pieces. So she plays the plunger solo. Great. So the end of the set comes, and she says, how was I? I said, you were great. Bobby comes up to her. He says, Britta, there's a man here who would like to meet you. He loved your solo. It was Kofi Annan, okay? The Secretary General of the UN.
Oh.
And so she came off, and, you know, her eyes were just like this, like, you know, what happened? And I said, the rest of your career is downhill from here. Her first solo in New York City, and the Secretary General of the UN says, you were wonderful, my dear. You know, it's kind of funny. But that was Bobby's world. You know, there was a birthday party for him one night, probably on his birthday, and Jesse Norman was there, who was a big fan of his and Friend, and she stood up in the back. It was the kind of thing like, well, his friends were, oh, and what's her puss? Hildegard was there.
The incomparable Hildegard.
Right. And the friends would stand up during the show on his birthday night and say something to Bobby. Dear Bobby, that kind of thing. Jesse Norman said that she learned as much about singing from Bobby Short as she did from anyone.
Wow.
How about that? And she wasn't, I believe it.
Oh, yeah.
Of course. Absolutely. Yeah. You know, he was on in the Heat of the Night. You remember that TV show with
I didn't know
Howard Rollins.
Walker, with Carol O'Connor.
Right.
Oh, yeah.
And Howard Rollins.
Right, yeah. And he played an itinerant blues singer with jeans, who wore jeans, and had to sing a blues, but he did it a la Bobby Short.
Oh, we got
to
find that. That's a clip.
We were on the road going from Corpus Christi to Galveston, Texas, in a stretch limousine with the band, in the middle of nowhere, And we pulled up to a gas station and we got out and Bobby went in to buy, you know, some water. And the young girl behind the counter, I mean, you showed Jackie Gleason during your tip jar thing, right? For a second.
Yes.
Okay, so, you know, I, you know, she did some version of, she recognized Bobby from In the Heat of the Night. She had no idea who he was or what he had done, but he had been on that episode. And then he told us that that happened all the time. One time we're backstage in California at UCLA, and Herb Jeffries came to hear Bobby.
Oh, nice.
And when he saw Herb Jeffries, he called him over and he went, Herb Jeffries.
Yep.
One time we're at the airport and we're waiting for the plane at the gate, and who walks by but Chubby Checker.
Oh my goodness.
And he paid obeisance.
Beth knows Chubby Checker, yes. What did he do?
He paid obeisance. You know, he really kind of like didn't bow and scrape, but he really was like Bobby Short, you know what I mean? He was like that. Yeah. Anyway,
all right. I got a great but obvious song to end with. And
great. And yes, part two is essential.
Yes. Maybe we won't wait till the next birthday. We'll think of another occasion. Yay.
Little as ever said about his private life, right? Other than we know about the accident, we know about this, stories about his sexuality, etc. But mostly, Cole Porter was very to himself.
Very private.
Very private.
Isn't it enough that he had this tremendous faith in words and fun with words? I mean, the lyrics are just...
He was.
Not to mention the music. I mean, it's...
Which were... But he was...
All we need.
Was his lyrics better than his music?
I don't know. He's one of those rare birds like Irving Berlin who did the whole thing, you see.
So it's hard to separate.
Yes. And Porter was always aware of words. His father was a great fan of Browning, the poet, you see. And he had a very thorough musical education, actually. And this enormous sophistication and interest in the language, which made him a great, great lyricist.
Another great love song he wrote was Every Time We Say Goodbye, right? Mm. Who's going to do that?
Karen. Me.
Okay, Karen Akers and Every Time We Say Goodbye.
Every time we say goodbye, I die a little. Every time we say goodbye, I wonder why a little. Why the gods above me, who must be in the know, think so little of me, they allow you to go. When you're near, there's such an air of spring about it. I can hear a lark somewhere begin to sing about it. There's no love song finer. Oh, but how strange the change from major to minor. Every time we say goodbye.
What a beautiful thought.
Lovely, yeah.
Well stated, too.
Thank
every
you.
Time we say goodbye, I
just
die a little.
Mm.
So until we meet again, goodbye, good luck, and may the good Lord take a liking to you.
Trails to you until we meet again. Happy trails to you. Keep smiling until then. Happy trails to you till we meet again.
We hate to leave. We hate to leave. We hate to leave. We hate to leave.
Come on.
ear. That's all, folks. Stop!
Nobody knows how dry I am. Nobody seems to give a rip and to the front of
This is the screwiest picture I was ever in.
Thank you, Eric and Lauren, for joining us. Tomorrow night, the John Hendricks birthday event. So you don't want to miss that. Next week, we're going to honor George Wein in the Newport Jazz Festival. And it's also Ray Charles's birthday. So, you know, stick around. Pay attention to your newsletters. Thank you, Bill Boggs. Thank you, Lauren Schoenberg. And thank you, Eric Comstock. We'll see you all very soon. Word up. Peace out. Go forth and sin no more.